produced by this mind, or the magnitude of perfection, is the composite one. The immensity arouses a sweet shudder that rushes through every fiber of our being, giving wings to the imagination to press further and further without stopping. All the sentiments blend together with the soul, flowing into one another and become a single phenomenon, which we call awe. And so we can say that the sublime is something sensuously perfect in art, capable of inspiring awe. The aesthetic category of the sublime is central to Mendelssohn's entire philosophical and cultural project, providing a conceptual kernel also to the critique of enlightenment. The engagement with the sublime seems to have furthermore constituted a crucial axis in Mendelssohn's participation in contemporary aesthetic disciplines. In enlightenment thought, the sublime was a cardinal rhetorical and aesthetic category which received particular prominence in 18th century intrinsic initially used to capture an emphatic, aesthetic, and emotional, poetic experience, including the affect of biblical poetry. 18th century Bible scholars and poets, usually of England and subsequently also in Germany, were fascinated with the power of the sublime to move the wide range of passions. By the mid-18th century, the sublime had entered also musical thought and compositional theory. The notion that to move the passions to transcend in sentiments, poetic intention was best expressed in music, was taken up by composers and music theorists of whom Hasid Mahler Bach, for example, was a main proponent. And just as the poetic sublime was located in metrical irregularity, complex syntax, and emotive language, as embodied in Cupcho's Odes, for example, so was its musical analogy, as found, for example, in the music of CPE, marked by free-ranging ideas, metrical liberties, and striking juxtapositions. 18th century music theorists described the musical sublime as that which exceeds the conceptual powers of the imagination, which appears too large and significant, too foreign and strange for the imagination to grasp it easily. Music, they maintained, can enhance the poetic sublime only through such complex harmonic means as delayed resolutions, progressions, dissonance, and the like. Not insignificantly, the fascination with the sublime played a role in liberating the emotional and moral function of music from the domination of Christian theology and metaphysics. In this sense, it was instrumental in opening up new sonic spheres that could be commonly shared by Christians and non-Christians alike on the basis of non-referential emotional and aesthetic experience. In other words, seems that if the capacity to be moved in sympathy in response to music had long been considered a manifestation of Christian moral virtue, enlightenment ideas of the latter half of the 18th century made the boundaries of aesthetic and emotional experience more neutral and increasingly coarse. Mendelssohn seems not only to have responded to such ideational transformations and developments, but also to have participated in engendering them and exploring them. Mendelssohn's first discussion of the sublime appears in the seminal 1757 review of Robert Lowe's Oxford Lectures on the Sacred Poetry of the Hebrews. With this aesthetic category, the sublime, Mendelssohn sought to capture Hebrew biblical poetry's plain, lucid style, its fiery language and visual imagery, praising the so-called oriental taste of the ancient Hebrew poets, and the sublime emotions that their poetry awakens. In this and subsequent essays on aesthetics and critical literary discussions written between the late 1750s and 1770s, Mendelssohn juxtaposed the sublime and the beautiful and constructed them as two separate yet complementary aesthetic categories and emotional experiences. Underscoring the differences in the rules of art made in the Kunst that the ancient Hebrew poets followed, in contrast to those followed by the ancient Greek and Roman poets, he positioned Hebrew biblical poetry as an alternative aesthetic ideal equal to, yet divergent from, Greco-Roman poetry. So the sublime and beautiful as Hebrew versus Greek and Roman. The Lowe's review, which included the earliest examples of Mendelssohn's Bible translation into German, and that biblical poetry, a reading that was equally new to Judaism as it was to Christianity. In associating the sublime with biblical poetry, Mendelssohn ultimately sought to secure for Hebrew poetry equal footing with the Greco-Roman origins of modern European poetry, and that indeed he also sought to claim for Judaism equal footing with Christianity. To Mendelssohn, the ultimate purpose of art is to evoke and speak sublime emotions, and if awe, bewundering, and amazement, erstaunen, are sources of the sublime, then music, being revealed progressively in time, lends itself most adequately to aesthetic, emotional, and ethical experience. Sublimity, eyesight, for example, cannot, by contrast, awaken such intense sublime sentiments in the same way that music can, according to Mendelssohn. But while Mendelssohn's observations about music's non-referentiality herald a new appreciation of instrumental music, one that is complete unto itself, void of concrete referent, a system of what he called natural signs, this non-referentiality prevents music from expressing and evoking specific sentiments. To be able to adequately express concrete sentiments, religious or others, music therefore must be wedded with what Mendelssohn called arbitrary signs, that is, words. As he explicates in On the Main Principles of Fine Arts of 1761. The expression of sentiment in music is intense, indeterminate. One is pervaded by a certain sentiment, but it is obscure and not limited to any individual object. This lack can be remedied by the addition of distinctive arbitrary signs, words. The words can make a sentiment into an individual sentiment. Coupled with poetry and painting or stage design, the result of the modern opera. Mendelssohn's discussion of the expression of sublime sentiments in words and music had appeared in his earliest discussion on the relationship between the Hebrew scriptures and music back in the Loth review of 1757. For Mendelssohn, as for Loth, the supreme and most ancient human representation of the sublime are the Psalms of David, proof of the musical and poetic primacy Judaism. And a quote from the Loth review: the Hebrews alone offer the earliest examples of poetic hymns in praise of God. Already before the kings, prophets were taught the art of song and poetry. Under the reign of King David, the art of music and poetry reached its highest degree. 4,000 singers and musicians alternately sang hymns in the temple. It was there that the most of the songs which have survived to the present day. The adequate response to the divine is then the human representation of divine perfection in music and poetry. These discrete descriptions of the power of marriage between words and music on both the mind and the sentiments refer to different experiences in the arts, opera for instance, and in religious worship. The triangular relationship between words, music, and meaning established in these and other earlier interjections reappears as a central theme in Mendelssohn's reword to the Pentateuch, where they are explored in concrete terms of the orality of biblical law and lyrical poetry. The orality of the Torah is thematized already in the extensive introduction to the commentary translation of the Pentateuch published in 1783. Or the Nitzvah, like for the calf, in a discussion about the function of the cultivations of the commandment. Echoing the concept of the relationship between music and words, Mendelssohn underscores the function of the cultivations not only as signs of syntactic articulation, but primarily as marks of oral expression of meaning. That is, the cultivations are the unwritten vocal expression of the affect of the biblical text by way of melody or chant, called zingun, a separate one for each emotional and rhetorical category, question, love, anger, hatred, and so on. Without the cantivations, Mendelssohn maintains, the words are what, quote, dry bones, void of living spirit, the words of the speaker almost incomprehensible, and if, then unappealing to the palate, like bland, unsalted food, and will not penetrate the listener's. The role of the cantivations is critical. They are essential for a correct exegesis of the biblical text. Mendelssohn had encountered 12th century book of the Kuzari. But departing and further interpreting Levy, Mendelssohn asserts in a paraphrase on Maimonides' introduction to Mishneh Torah that although the biblical text was given by Moses in written form to the people of Israel without translations, Moses himself heard the entire Torah recited by God with the proper vocalization, intonation, and cantillations, and proclaimed it in his turn to Joshua, who recited it to the elders of Israel, from whom the tradition continues. This procedure constitutes a perpetual practice of reenactment. As he further describes there, the child learning from his father or other people listening to his teacher would hear these enunciations with whatever was appropriate for their proper pronunciation, just as he had also received it from his father or teacher. Then continues, they would not give their children the written text only, because this would be to them as a sealed book. But they read to them out loud and chanted. They would thereby transmit to them the Torah's intonation notes, and would sweeten its words like a penny, so that the words might enter their hearts and remain there as firmly implanted with oaths and nails. This description seems to resonate with a much earlier fragmentary letters on art, where Mendelssohn has stipulated back in 70, around 60, on the power of words wedded with music. The purpose of this inestimable art, music that is to make the effect of poetry on our minds more emphatic, more vital, and more passionate. When a song in praise of God, wisdom, or virtue is sung with explicating the innermost emotions of the words and the to arouse. And the passage continues in an almost ecstatic crescendo, sensationally smacking of Sturm und Drang. The rational perception of the sung words masters our soul, and the pleasantness of the tones through which the words are carried puts our senses into the state of the affect that they are supposed to arouse. Excitement becomes total. We are simultaneously pulled away against our will, accompanied by joy and delight on our way to heaven. In the same vein, by attributing the cantillations to the text that was revealed to Moses at Sinai, Mendelssohn constructs a defense of the authenticity and unambiguity of the Torah. It is the orality of biblical text, its inherent intonation, prosody, and mimicry gestures that reduce ambiguity. And this argument reappears also in his political theological essay, Jerusalem, Jerusalem, published that same year, 1783, which might shed some light on the political deliberations perhaps behind the engagement with music and language in the war in the Bible. In contrast, Mendelssohn contends texts transmitted in written form are subject to copying or printing mistakes and editorial changes. Yet the aura of the musical transmission of the Torah is not only innate to the revealed text, lending it its meaning and safeguarding its authenticity. It also constitutes the reenactment of divine revelation itself, generation after generation. The defense of the singularity of Hebrew Bible, reaches its pinnacle in Mendelssohn's explication of biblical poetry. What was only touched upon in 1757 review of Robert Lowe is fully elaborated in explicitly musical terms in the word in Mendelssohn's extensive introduction to Exodus 15, the Song of the Sea. Reiterating his contention regarding the unmetered verse of Hebrew poetry, which once again brings to mind Judaism, invokes the aesthetics of the sublime by which he had explicated the rules of art, as he calls it, that distinguished biblical poetry from its Greco-Roman counterpart and from contemporary European poetry. In the introduction to the Song of the Sea, Exodus 15, however, we learn that it is precisely the unmetered verse of Hebrew poetry that constitutes one of the sources of its singularity and sublimity. It moreover lends itself most adequately to music for, and I quote, there is neither advantage nor excellence in the measuring of syllables in one verse, except with respect to their pleasantness of the sound to the ear. More important than mere sensuous delight is the intended meaning and content, which is the purpose for the utterance. Here, Mendelssohn addresses the core question of the translatability of poetry. Translating metered verse is likened to, and I quote, pouring good oil from one vessel into another such that its fragrance is completely lost. The syllabic meter is intimately conferred to a particular language. The nature of Hebrew poetry, being non-syllabic and unmetered, is thus its safeguard if this nature is maintained also in the translation. While meter affords only meager excellence, a more noble excellence arises from arranging content and statements in a beautiful way intended for the end desire in poetry, namely that the words enter not only the listener's ear, but also his heart, firmly establishing within them the virtues and excellent dispositions, like stakes that will not be dislodged. It is in this manner, Mendelssohn asserts, that, quote, our ancestors chose to order their noble phrases in a manner that agrees with the art of music. In turn, the non-referentiality of music itself requires no translation at all, and hence offers a universal aesthetic experience. The conclusion of this elaborate introduction sheds light on Mendelssohn's entire translation project. The wondrous science, as he calls it, of musical poetry possessed by ancient Hebrews has been entirely lost during exile, but the sweetness of the content, which is connected to the meaning and intention of the statement rather than to the sound of the voice, nonetheless remains in our sacred poetry that is sensed by every wise reader. Its translation into another language maintains, therefore, what he calls that same sweetness, and he concludes, the poetic magnificence is not entirely destroyed as it occurs in the translation of foreign poetry, that is, European poetry. By the same token, also the music of the ancient Hebrews is distinct from European contemporary music, as he admonishes the reader. Do not imagine that the art of music that we know today was anything like that the illustrious wisdom used by those complete artists, the ancient Hebrews, the poet and musicians of the Hebrews, since it seems that no such resemblance exists. The primacy of meaning and idea inherent to the completeness of the intellect was abandoned in favor of the sound, which is nothing but sensuous delight and pleasure to the ear. Reading these lines, we begin to realize, perhaps, what Mendelssohn had meant back in 1755 when he wrote in On the Sentiments about music that it is fine art. Perhaps he had imagined a kind of a prototype ideal of music, of that wondrous science inherent in the poetry of the ancient Hebrews, the musical representation of the divine that had reached its climax in the temple, where, as he writes in the Lowe's Review, 4,000 singers and musicians alternatingly sang hymns accompanied by their musical instruments. It is then, Mendelssohn tells us, the duality of words and music that constitutes biblical poetry, safeguards its true meaning and ensures its universality. And what better demonstrates the universality and authenticity of the Hebrew Bible than the Psalms, the supreme, most sublime form of Hebrew lyrical poetry? Mendelssohn did not perceive the Psalms in prophetic, exegetic terms, but he did see them as the ultimate musical expression of devotion, proof of Judaism's ancient enlightenment by virtue of their inherent musicality, and that already in the 1750s, as we read earlier. Little wonder then that for his translation of the Book of Psalms, Mendelssohn chose a publication in German characters without commentary, a publication intended for a broad, primarily non-Jewish readership. And let's remember that the translation of the rest of the Bible in the Word Project was written in German and Hebrew characters. A letter to his Lutheran friend, Sophie Becker, written on the 24th of December, 1785, only a few days before his death, gives us an idea of the universal significance that Mendelssohn attributed to the singing of Psalms. album hearing and like his own accounts. We sing unto ourselves, and that the wise man does as well as the fool. Have you ever read the Psalms with this intention? It seems to me that many of the Psalms must be sung by the most enlightened person with true education. I would recommend to you my translation. So much is beyond doubt. The Psalms have sweetened many bitter hours for me, and I sing and pray them whenever I feel the need to sing. The Psalms translation evidently awakened the curiosity of contemporary composers, including some of Berlin's foremost musicians. Fasch, Eichert, and Kirnberger, who sought to explore the new texts and musical settings, of which only a handful have survived in manuscripts and only fragmentary. We can only speculate on Mendelssohn's thought of those compositions, some of which were performed in Berlin already in the 1770s. The translation was only published in 1783, right? But it seems that, like other Jewish exegetes before him, Mendelssohn maintained a mythological notion, as it were, of the lost wisdom of the Hebrews, of that divine art of music. Evidently preferred those ancient chants that connected him to the singing of the Levites in the temple, where it is believed most of the Psalms were created, which have survived. The dedication of the Psalms translation to Mendelssohn's Lutheran friend, Karl Wilhelm Ramanauer, a leading poet and aesthetician of the Berliner Aufklärung and reviver of the Croatian ode tradition, embodies the dialogue Mendelssohn had attempted to create between Hebrew poetry and European poetry, between Judaism and Hellenism, Jerusalem and Athens. Ramanauer, in turn, seems to have been one of the few non-Jews who understood the political tenor of Mendelssohn's allegedly apolitical aesthetics. In his libretto of Memorial Cantatas to Amito Eusebia, written shortly after Mendelssohn's death in 1786, Ramanauer deployed Mendelssohn's translation of Psalm 23, God's My Shepherd, as an epilogue to the piece. Ramanauer thereby not only breaks with the exclusivity of Luther's paradigmatic translation, but he also advocated a pluralistic cultural vision that celebrates Judaism's ancient enlightenment within German culture, musical culture. By paraphrasing the text of the Psalm as if spoken from eternity by Mendelssohn's immortal soul, so you see, ich warte instead of so warte ich in Furcht, so past tense, as if there was someone speaking, Ramanauer underscored Mendelssohn's role in departing from Christological and prophetic readings, giving the Jewish philosopher a public voice louder than the one he had enjoyed during his lifetime, and that in music. Indeed, the figure of King David holding a harp while humbly kneeling in a pensive devotional gesture on the frontispiece of the Psalms added to the image of Mendelssohn, the philosopher, hailed as the German Socrates, a further dimension, that of a modern psalmist. Ramanauer's Cantatas to Amito Eusebia has celebrated Judaism's aesthetic relevance as bearer of an authentic enlightened tradition that is as ancient as the Psalms, proclaiming biblical poetry as specifically Jewish and at the same time universal, reiterating and further interpreting in a public, audible form Mendelssohn's critique of the marginalization of Judaism, of Jerusalem, as it were, in favor of Athens, or Stettin, as Berlin was called in the 18th century, within the German and Christian-dominated Enlightenment. Now, I have only a few remarks in conclusion. So we saw that by embedding aesthetic notions into the biblical commentary, rendering modern philosophy a natural hermeneutical continuation or a component of Jewish thought, Mendelssohn's translation and commentary project attempted a defense of Judaism and its cultural authenticity, turning the inferiority of Hebrew poetry, as it was seen for non-Jewish eyes, into a source of defiance. Partaking in the Jewish tradition, uninterrupted exegetic continuum, Mendelssohn claimed Judaism's relevance within the religious and cultural discourse of Enlightenment. In so doing, he embraced the potential for linking aesthetics, and music in particular, with the argument in favor of Judaism's inherent enlightenment and ultimately the political project of Jewish civic betterment. While the war was largely directed toward a Jewish readership, the pivotal place ascribed in it to music should, I think, be seen also as a dual response, both inward and outward, to the non-Jewish world, a world that had for centuries denied Judaism's musical relevance and excluded it from the harmony of European Christianity. Mendelssohn has straddled the two conceptual universes. May have been aware of the new sense of Jewish consciousness that he was helping to formulate, one that would become the hallmark, perhaps, of European Jewish modernity, what Freud called repetition with difference, a constant awareness of the past in terms of the present through continuous interpretation and an unceasing negotiation of boundaries.
Notified that we cannot, under any circumstance, go past 12 o'clock. It is now where I have 5 minutes. Well, we have time for a couple of questions.
Mendelssohn is unwittingly performing an act of secularization by making available this experience of being moved by music as not exclusively Christian. And then on the other hand, as you mentioned, he's drawing out a vision of enlightenment as something that's pre-existing within a Jewish ancient text of the Psalms. Do you see him in a way arguing for something Judaic within the Enlightenment, the idea that reason and universal is somehow Judaic to begin with? And that leads to the question, what happens to the sacred in its Christian understanding?
I'll be very, very brief. The answer to the first question is probably yes, but we can talk, but it needs to be discussed. And the second question, I didn't pick up.
About the sacred, as it's in the idea of being moved as music, because at the end he seems to refer to this is all about aesthetic pleasure, ultimately.
No, it's not about only aesthetic.
Talking about the Christian, a new idea of music, in the Berlin Atenandersprey experience of music, it's about aesthetic pleasure. But in terms of his understanding the role of the sacred with musical devotion amongst Christians, what happens to that then in his vision?
That's a very good question. I have to think about it because I don't know that he wrote about that.
I have time for a single question. Yeah?
If Mendelssohn had lived into the period of early Reform Judaism, wouldn't he have been in a terrible contradiction because he's on the one hand celebrating the musicality and choir of ancient Judaism, but in modern, quote, Orthodox traditional Judaism, instrumentalization, as opposed to chanting the Torah, is forbidden. Well, what would he have done?
Wow.
And I'm that definitive.